do that spiel however you want to.
Okay.
You ready?
But you will lead me through all this, right?
Well, but I'm going to help lead you
right,
through it.
Right.
It's not all at one time.
Yes.
So you just relax and we'll get
okay.
to most of it. Good afternoon, JoAnne. We're glad that you could join us in capturing the story of our community. Tell us your name and where you were born.
Thank you, Verna Jean. I'm JoAnne Thornton. I was born in Rock Island, Illinois, and grew up in Davenport, Iowa, which was just across the river on the Mississippi River, and lived there for most of my life. Went to Coe College in Cedar Rapids, Iowa, which is like an hour and a half away from the Quad Cities, and then married, and we lived there for a long time. My husband was transferred to Austin in 1987, so that's how we got to Texas.
Okay. And so what were you doing in 1965?
Oh, my goodness. I think I had three little children, and my youngest child was just a year old at that time. And I do remember The Sound of Music. That was a big thing then. It's one of my favorite things still. But peculiar to that is that year, I think that both my husband's and my parents came for Christmas because we were the only ones that had grandchildren at that time. And we gave them tickets to The Sound of Music for Christmas. And I thought that was a great thing, but they weren't quite as thrilled as I was about that whole thing. But just dealing with small children, that's mostly what I remember at that time.
So what brought you to Pflugerville? What's your interest?
Well, as I said, we came here in 1987 with my husband's job. And prior to that time, I had been a county librarian in Iowa. And we moved, and I had no children, nothing, you know, at home. And so I was looking for something to do and saw a small want ad in the paper looking for a librarian in the small town library. And it was Pflugerville. And so I applied for it and came and had the interview and that whole thing.
And who did you interview with?
The friends were the owners of the library at that time. It's Pflugerville Community Library, and it was at 102 South 3rd Street, which is still the building in existence. And the friends of the library were owners and operators of the library. So they're the ones who interviewed me. Nadine Whiteley was president at that time. Audrey Deering was on the board. She probably was treasurer because that's been her lifelong thing, I think, to be treasurer of that organization. Muff Phillips was on the board. Nancy Pruitt was on the board. Carolyn Olson, Laura Gage. Let me see. That probably is a majority of them. There are others I really don't remember right now.
And when the ad said small town, it really was small town. What was your first impression when you drove through this small town?
Well, it was just a nice rural town. It was really separated from Austin at that point. Sort of separate. It wasn't together like it is now. You can hardly tell the difference when you come from one to the other at this point. But at that point, it was a small town, cozy kind of feel. There are lots of neat old houses which still exist. And the library was in the house, and it was just a charming, intimate little place that it seemed to be really neat for a library. And I liked it right away and thought, oh, I hope I get this job. And waited a little while to find out. But
my mother-in-law had actually had a nursery in that house before it became
Really?
Library. So it had been used for community service in a sense before.
Uh-huh.
So what were some of your first priorities after you took the role?
I wanted to get us into the 20th century at that point, I think. It was 1987. I think it was July of 1987. And the friends had done a marvelous job of getting it all together. But they didn't. You know, they were all non-librarians. I mean, there were wonderful volunteers doing their job and as well as they could, and they did a marvelous job of it, putting it together and raising money and the whole thing. I really wanted to get us up to snuff and in more modern techniques and that kind of thing. One of the things that appalled me was that one of the things they did when the kids checked out books, they let the kids write their own names. And we had all these book cards with wonderful little scribblings from kids, and you couldn't read any of them because the kids, you know, had just learned to write. Mm-hmm. And so we did a fairly quickly, we did what we called a Gaylord system, and it was a little machine that ka-chunk, 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 and printed a number on the card, and no one had to write their name and that sort of thing. But and that was kind of interesting because everybody thought that was neat, and so they didn't feel bad about not having their kid write the name, you know.
So when you, what were your hours in the beginning?
They were just part-time, and I think it was maybe, I'm trying to remember. We were open Saturday mornings, and I think at 3 days during the week, not full days, you know, part-time during those days. And wonderful volunteers who had done that same thing for years. Dorothy Tinsley came every Saturday morning. Every Saturday morning, Dorothy was there doing that. Several of them, Mildred Marshall was one. And Carolyn Olson came a lot. Lots of them, and there were so many volunteers in and out. It was great. And they all knew everything. They all knew how to shelve books, how to check out, and, you know, how to do all that kind of stuff. It was great. It was wonderful.
So at what point did you get a staff?
It was a while. I think it was, let's see. We finally determined that if we could get a staff person, we'd have more consistency, and we'd be able to follow up on some things better if we could do that, because I couldn't do all of that. And volunteers are wonderful, but sometimes, you know, their priorities are not always what you think they should be. So I think it was 1990. It was after that. I don't know. I can't remember.
But anyways, you had to also be somewhat in charge of delegating the volunteers as to what their roles would be and to move
right.
forward. So
right.
the participation in the library began to grow mm-hmm. because it was open more hours, and maybe the number of books are. Was
right.
there any other services you offered other than just checking books in and out?
Oh, yeah.
At that level?
Yes, yes. From the beginning, the Friends, which drove this library, one of their priorities was to be a place where everyone could come and find what they needed and have a good time and, you know, promote literacy and that sort of thing. And so we had story hours, which were gangbuster story hours. We had 300 and 400 kids at that house. And sometimes we had to have them out in the yard under the big trees, which was kind of nice, except when it was 100 degrees or something. But so we had that, and we started trying to do other kinds of programs. We had mystery adult reading program, which did mysteries. We had a gardening club. We had the kids from the summer camp that met at the park came up every summer once a week, and we did story hour and whatever with them. We did, one of the things we did was a Renaissance thing one time, and we had a group come in and play Renaissance music. They were dressed in costume. That was fun. And we had a lot of people for that. Just those kinds of things, many of which they're doing now at the library with this huge building and a bigger staff. But we did a lot of that kind of thing, trying to draw the public in and make them realize that we have more here than books and reading, you know.
So at what point was there discussion of a permanent building or a new building?
The Friends had always, always wanted a permanent building of their own. And so at one point, and so that was always in the back of their mind, I think. One of the things they did in order to help maintain the library and make more money was have a thrift shop at the corner of 4th and where there's a gift shop there now. It's still there. It was owned by Audrey and Leonard Deering, and they allowed us to rent that for them. And we had a thrift shop for several years, maybe 8 years, to raise money. And they always thought that this money would go after, you know, keeping the library running, that they would have some money to go to that. And then we also, they discovered this perfect lot on which the library sits now for sale, and thought, oh, maybe they could swing this and have this as a permanent location for the library. So somehow they were able to purchase that, and they put up a big sign, Future Home of the Pflugerville Community Library, and it was up for several years. And then during this time, they were in the Friends were in negotiation with the city to have the library become a department of the city. And my timing is not right. I'm not sure. About 1991 or 92, I think, they purchased the land, which belonged to the Friends, but sort of used it as a carrot in front of the city and said, this can be a place for a new library, and are you willing to, you know, take this? And so, was it Haywood Weir who was president at that time, perhaps? And talked to the council and everything, and there was a consideration for the land would be deeded to the city as a place for the library if they guaranteed it would be built within 3 years. So that went through, and it was, you know, they were euphoric about that whole thing because finally they were getting.
So were you involved in actually, you and the Friends, in the design of the actual building?
Yeah, we were. They had meetings, or they call them something special, when they're having meetings for architectural things. And people came and, you know, suggested things. And we had, at that time, we had a library board, which was, actually, we had become a department of the library before that happened. I mean, department of the city before that happened. So the library board was a department, you know, was part of the city. The library board had input. The Friends had input. We had community people who came and said, we got help from CTLS's Central Texas Library System, which is the state support for small libraries. All around the state, and they came and did some help for us. So we got all kinds of ideas. And
did you go around and visit other libraries in the area?
Yeah, we did. Actually, because I was a member of CTLS, a small libraries group, I had seen a lot of them, you know, around, traveled around to a lot of them. And we were one of the smallest libraries in that group at that time. But we had seen Georgetown go up. We had seen West Bank go up. And West Bank was also a volunteer library. So we got a lot of information from them. And just everybody really was helpful in doing that. We had a whole list of things, and some of them were off the wall, but you know, when you're thinking about something like that, you want to think a little off the wall too, because it could happen, and a lot of it did.
So then it came to reality, and there was the grand opening and our gala. I know that you continued the fundraising, and mm-hmm. I think there were bricks for sale, and then I think the First Lady of Texas was a librarian, and she was able to attend. So tell us about planning the gala and the event.
The gala was something that the Friends thought we could have in conjunction with the opening of the new building, which is now the old part of the building we have. And it was because the building was so visible on Pecan Street, people finally realized there was a library here, and it was a viable organization that, you know, was going someplace. Before, it seemed to be the smallest, just best-kept secret in Pflugerville, because it was a small place and that sort of thing. But because it was so visible there on Pecan Street, we decided that maybe we could do this. So they organized a gala for just before the opening of the new building in 1999, February 1999. And we had a wonderful committee of people who went out and solicited from all the big organizations that had really helped us during the year, through the years anyway, IBM and Dell and Traycor, which is where Audrey worked for so long. I can't even remember all of them, but there were a multitude of places that helped, plus individuals who were willing to give money for one thing or another. A lot of the time we accepted in-kind stuff because we had some wiring done, in-kind donation. We had furniture given, those kinds of things that we needed in a new building. And I think, I can't remember how big the committee was. See, it's fairly large because people had seen that building and they were excited about it, and they came to volunteer to help with funding it and with furnishing it and that sort of thing. And so we had a fairly large committee, and then the gala was just before we opened in February, and I think we raised $60,000 through that gala. We had Liz Carpenter there, we had Jake Pickle there, we had the people, the talkers, who had given us money for automation. We had 250 people from the community there. It was a wonderful event. And we have a video of it too, which is kind of fun to watch. But it was a tremendous, tremendous event, I think.
Talk about how technology changed from your very beginning in a little house to actually when you retired. In what year?
I retired in 2003.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Well, as I referred to before, when I came, we were using hand stamps, and kids were writing their names individually on the cards, the book cards. And in 1985, maybe, we were lucky enough to write a grant to the Talker Foundation, which was a family organization which helped small libraries in Central Texas. And you had to be stringent, you know, things to follow. And we were looking for money for automation for our library. We had gone from the handwriting to the ka-chink, ka-chink machine, Gaylord machine, and we wanted to be automated next, which was, at that time, was the thing to do, you know. We were successful in writing a grant. We had help from the city and from another organization that helped us. And so we received $25,000 for automation. And it was a huge amount of money for our little library. I mean, it was a small library, and we were just, it was so neat to get that. Everyone was so excited about it. And that year in at TLA, which is Texas Library Association, I usually went every year. It's where you find out all kinds of new things and order new books and get new contacts and those kinds of things. Laura Bush was one of the promoters of, she was a speaker that year, I think, at TLA. And of course, as you said, she was had been a librarian, and so she was very interested in small libraries. She announced our name, and we got to stand up and, you know, all that thing at TLA. And at that point, I thought, we need to find her, get her to come to us for our gala or for our opening or something. So we announced that we got the Tucker grant and continued with the automation. And then that I was lucky enough to be able to see Mrs. Bush at that convention and ask her whether it would be possible for her to come to our gala. And no, not the gala, to the dedication of the library, which was the same year in April, 1999 in April, and during National Library Week. And she was very gracious and said, well, I don't know, I have to check my calendar, as most famous people would have to. And she said, write to my secretary and, you know, we'll let you know. So I did that, and she said yes. So she came for that. That was really great. So that was 1999. Mrs. Bush came to the opening then.
Libraries, as you said, serve a wide array of mm-hmm. citizens. Usually it starts off with books of all
right.
for all ages. But what about additional programs and our resources for adult education? Did the library expand in that particular area?
Yes, yes. We early on, even in the old house, we did ESL classes for, we had one particular lady who was interested in doing that, and she came to me and asked if that would be possible, if we could provide the space. Well, we had that, you know, we had the space over there. And it's not like you'd have a huge group at one time. She did a one-on-one. And so she started at the old library doing that. And when we moved to the new place in 99, she continued and I think expanded her classes or her students to make to more of them. So she continued to do that for a long time. We did computer classes. When we moved to the new building, we had computers for the public, and we had computer classes for seniors, computer classes for, well, I don't know, I can't remember all of them, but we had quite a few. And then people came in regularly to do, you know, their email and all this kind of stuff, which initially we had to train them in. A lot of people didn't have computers at home at that time. But
I was at the city council workshop this past Tuesday, and there was a screen of data presented on the amount of visits to the library today in perspective, and it's amazing how the library is such an integral core of this community and likely any other community, mm-hmm. but it has played a vital role in the development.
Right.
And it's very commendable for all of the people who did the fundamental legwork and built that firm foundation. Mm-hmm. To spring forth, and being in a visible location that you mentioned, I think
right.
remains today
right.
a critical thing that the library is
yeah.
easy to find, easy to see, and easy to use.
Right. I've always maintained that a town needs good parks, good schools, good libraries, and that's about it. You can have a really good town if you have those things.
Mm-hmm. So. Are there any key characters that you met in the city or the town, the community, when you were outside of the library?
Well, for a long time, he didn't live here. We lived in Round Rock, and so my job kept me here, and I met people, city council, and through the library, you know. Made some very good friends through the library, of course. But Audrey has been the steadfast person all these many years. Nadine Whiteley was, as I said, president of the library board when I was hired, and she stayed a long time. In fact, she was the one who took me, and the first day I went to work at the library, you know, Nadine was there and showed me the ropes, and it was fun to meet her and work with her. And then all of those friends were so accommodating and so helpful and everything, and so enthusiastic about what they were doing, and the friends still maintain that kind of thing, I think. Although it's a different group of people, except for Audrey. Audrey's still with us, fortunately. I remember, I had good boards, good library boards, and a couple of people. Cliff Avery was a good advocate for the library when he was library board chair. There's the friends board and the library board, and sometimes they were confusing. But, I had a whole bunch of people.
How does a citizen get involved with either the Friends or to be on the library board?
Yeah. The Friends is open to anyone who's interested and wants to pay their money and wants to come and help us work once in a while. And we don't have a very large Friends group, but it's very cooperative, and they work together well, and they're good people. They just have the interests of the library at heart, and anybody can be a friend who lives in our service area. In order to be on the library board, you must be a member. You must be a community Pflugerville resident, and I believe that. In January or December or January, you go to city council and say, I want to do this, and they'll give you an application and allow you to do that. And so the library board is from the whole community. It seems to be, actually we always have more men on the library board than we do on the Friends board, so.
For many years, along with the thrift shop, the Friends are whatever they had, book sales that mm-hmm. were, tell us about getting ready for them and where the books came from what a book sale was like.
Yeah, well, in the beginning, the book sales were one of the major ways to make money for the Friends. And at that point, before Pflugerville was so big and had grown so much, we were able to use a place in Windermere, the Windermere Shopping Center, which was at that time was undercover, but it wasn't completed building. I mean, inside it was still dirt floors. And so the owner, I suspect it was the owner of that area, let us use that for a book sale, and it was a massive book sale. Plus, we had furniture from Traycor and IBM, and I don't know who all. They had given all this stuff to us for our book sale, and so we sold all that also. And so it was a matter of taking things. We always had to have a storage unit to keep books until the book sale time. So it was a matter of taking them from the storage unit to that place and putting them on tables, borrowing tables from the city or churches or wherever was available, and putting the books on there and arranging them and all that sort of stuff. And then we had to have people there all the time to, you know, man the sale and that sort of thing. So those were really huge, huge sales. In later years, we had them at various places around the city. Because our 102 3rd Street wasn't a very big facility, we could not have any book sales there. So we had them. A couple of times we had them in this building, when it was, no, in the other city council building on Main Street before it was all divided into smaller offices. We had it, where else do we have them?
The number of volunteers for a book sale, mm-hmm. I mean, you had your friends, but would they get their spouses and complete families? How did you man them?
Right, we did. Yes, you brought your husband and all your kids, if they were old enough to lug a box of books. You brought everybody and your neighbors, and you're right, everyone got involved in that. And it was great because people could see the need, and people could see it was a good because you could get cheap books for one thing also. So it was a good deal.
I want to talk a little bit about Nadine Whiteley. Mm. We have her memory today.
Yes.
But she was a strong, spunky, motivated.
Right.
Sometimes aggressive.
Yes.
Leader.
Yes.
But very determined to reach the goal.
Mm-hmm.
And I can see her working at the Windermere location that you just said when you were dealing with big equipment, she would likely...
Right.
Tell people what they needed to do to make it happen.
Right, right. She would. Excuse me. She was. Thinking back, she's a little intimidating to me. I think I had never met someone like that personally, and dealt with them. But she knew what she wanted, and she said her piece and did what she needed to do. And got things done, that's for sure.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so is there anything else you would like to say about the library that maybe we haven't talked about? I would assume that house in the wintertime was sometimes challenging to keep warm.
Oh, it was an interesting place to work, yeah. The windows were not very tight, and yeah. Yeah, except it was, I see people today who say, oh, I miss the old house. It was so fun, and it was so cozy, and those kinds of things, you know. It was a whole different world when we were at that house. Pflugerville was a relatively small town, and everybody seemed to know everybody else. And that's no longer the case. I mean, we're a large town now. And we have lots and lots of people who have moved from other places. So it's not like they're hometown boys anymore. So I think we deserve this library we've got now. And it's very well used and very well stocked. They've got all kinds of neat things there that we didn't have before and didn't even think about, partly because of the march of time. You know, everything changes and gets better. But wonderful things there, and I think it's a really great facility, and I'm proud of the whole thing. And I think the Friends have much to be proud of because of all their work initially. I mean, they did all that. They did all that. Couldn't even think of what it might be in the end.
And when you think about birthing something, we can all go through birth similarities,
mm-hmm.
But to birth an organization from $0 to right. whatever the budget might be today on the city side, and to stay with it and make it sustainable,
yes,
is a huge commitment of not human resources as well as monetary and mm-hmm. financial resources.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yes, it is. Yes, and that's wonderful because that finally has happened here. Mm-hmm. The Friends struggled to get help from the city initially because at some point it was a small town and they felt maybe we didn't need a library here. We don't want to spend the money on a library when we need money for something else. But they did realize finally that, yes, this is something we need to do. We need to sustain.
Well, they were persistent,
right.
the
right.
Friends were, and again, through hard times, sometimes you mm-hmm. see the library as a non-essential because it's not food, clothing, and
right.
whatever, but in the reality, it does prove to be the core and the learning center. And it's a stable entity that's there.
Right.
As citizens come and go, as generations come and go, your library remains
right.
a landmark and a cornerstone.
Yeah.
And maybe even a touchstone.
And in bad times, the library is really essential. In spite of, you know, yes, you provide food or those things, but there are other things that are necessary that the library provides in hard times.
It's nearly a sanctuary.
Yes.
Do you remember The Window of the World?
Oh, yes.
Let's talk about that.
Sure. We shouldn't forget that. All along, during the time the Friends were involved in the new building and in the purchase of the land, the whole thing, they had decided that there needed to be something to memorialize or, was that the right word?
Capture.
Yeah, capture, yes, good. The spirit of the old Friends, the original group that started the Friends in 1981. And so they pondered about what that might be. And they looked at this new building, and it was so nice. There are so many possibilities they could do. And they thought about, oh, let's put a statue somewhere. Well, then the point is, what statue would it be, and who would it be, and all those sorts of things, you know. Well, we could put a fountain out there. And then we thought, oh, yeah, kids would really love playing in this fountain. And then we'd have to clean it every day and all those sorts of things. So finally, they came up with the stained glass window concept. And I think Audrey and a couple of some of the other Friends, but particularly Audrey, found this. It was soft sculpture wall hanging that had been used, and it was similar to the Window of the World. It was a globe with the children all around there. And so she took that idea to some Friends, and it evolved into our stained glass window, which is massive stained glass window. I think there are 16 4x4 panels on that window, and it faces south in the part of the library, which is now old but was new. And the sun come through it, and those stained glass glasses, it's really beautiful. But it pictures their idea of what a library should be. It should be the world, and it should have children and let them, you know, do what they want. And so that's how
And they're connected.
Yeah, right, right.
There were volunteers involved in that also, I think, in the design and also in actually
absolutely.
Putting the stained glass together.
Yes,
Ray
absolutely.
Kramer was one.
Yes, I lost that. Yes, and Audrey sort of shotgunned the whole thing. You know, she coordinated it and helped some in some of the things. But Rick Kramer, who had been a patron of the library forever, at the old house even, did it. And with help from several people at that time. So, and it took, I think it took about 2 years to get it completed. And then we had a dedication for it, and
So did the Friends buy the pieces of stained glass, and then he did he was the craftsman that put it.
Mm-hmm.
Jan.
Yes, what's her name?
Yeah, it was Jan.
Yes.
Spears.
Yes, that's right. That's right. Yeah, and she always used to bring her the preschool kids from the Lutheran Church down for story hour all the time. Yeah, and then she was involved in that, helping that with Ray. So yes, they bought all the glass, all the equipment, everything, and because it's so huge, they had to bring in a cherry picker to put them up. It was a really massive project, and then they also, I think it's backed. The stained glass is there, and then it's got glass on the front of it as a protection kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So it's a permanent thing there. It'll be.
So, did you ever have the opportunity to talk to Ray Kramer, who put this thing
about
on?
The yeah about the, well, I don't expect I have. I don't particularly remember that. His wife is on the Friends board right now. Yeah. Ray was fun because he would come to the library, or actually he would call our old library, the house, and say, "This is Ray Kramer. Do you have anything to read?" And I thought, oh my gosh, this is the pastor. I don't know if I want to choose books for him or not. But
he was a character.
Yes, yeah. And he'd come in and take what I had chosen for him. It was funny. But he was very, yeah. He was funny.
Did you have any other interesting patrons that you remember that had their uniqueness and special requests of things that they wanted you to find?
Oh, my goodness. I don't know. You know, they all blend into one wonderful person. But the fun part of it is, now that I live in Pflugerville, I see people that were children when I started, and now they're grown. You know, they're grown, and some of them have children of their own. And I thought, oh, goodness, time flies. You know?
So it's really a lifelong relationship.
Yes.
That you connect with.
Yes.
With that. Mm-hmm. Well, thank you so much, JoAnne, for being a game player and a changer in our community, and for providing with your group of volunteers and the partnership that you formed with them to make this library a reality and certainly a cornerstone for the future. And I guess another interesting thing when we project out 2, 5, 10 years, you know, we're now at nearly 54,000 people.
Mm-hmm.
So we're no longer a little town.
Right.
But would you envision that there would someday need to be satellites, or how do you keep that feeling of the library usage when your town gets so big and maybe the mobility is an issue or whatever it could mm-hmm. be, or issues?
I suspect that there will be branches or satellites at some point. Actually, the library board has talked about that for several years, and you know, that's a logistical thing. You have to have a location, you have to have people, all that kind of thing to do that. But my goodness, we're certainly big enough to have that kind of thing right now. And because Pflugerville is sort of separated by 130, we have, you know, a lot of growth on the other side of 130, that would be a logical place where a satellite or branch off. And I think that probably will happen.
Well, and for people of my generation, we read and hear stories about how libraries will, quote, become not extinct, but their delivery will be very different with all mm-hmm. the electronic means and technology. And in fact, in larger towns, there's challenges if they want to keep a traditional library.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Do you have any opinions on
that? Well, everybody says books are going to go away, and I don't think that will ever happen. But you're right. If you go into the library now, you see one of the first things you see is all their books on tape, you know, or their audio books, hundreds of them, which we didn't have before. And you can download iTunes through the library. You can do all that stuff through the library, which is really great because it doesn't cost anything to do that through the library, you know. I think that there are just so many other things they'll offer, but I don't think books are ever going to go away. Hopefully. I mean, I don't like them to go away. I prefer a book. You know.
Well, I think an important city service also is when we look at the demographics mm-hmm. of the United States, Texas, Pflugerville, Travis County, we know that at some periods of time, the economically disadvantaged subgroup seems to be growing. And for particularly that group, as well as other groups, the library is very vital for them
right.
because we know that education is a means of improving your quality
mm-hmm.
of life.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, that's evident. You know, we have the library has computers for the public. Most people apparently do not have a computer at home. And I think we assume a whole lot that most people have computers at home, and that's not necessarily true. Most people are in there every day checking their email or applying for jobs or looking for jobs and that sort of thing on those computers because they don't have access at home. We also have other languages there that people, you know, we have, anyway, we have Spanish, which is obvious in Texas, but there's several other ones which, you know, help people at their job and at school, and have all those kids that don't speak English.
Well, and when we use the phrase lifelong learners, it is when they finish their formal learning in some school or institution, a lot of that becomes personalized, and the library is the subsidy or the provider for a lot of that continued learning.
Yes, yeah.
Likewise, if we take 20 years ago, everybody received and read the newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
And in today's world, a subscription to the Austin American Statesman is well over $200 mm-hmm. for a year. And broken down, that's impacts people's individual budgets. So having the library to access some of this is their only means.
Yes, right, right. And so that's one of the things, you know, one of the areas in the new library is called the living room. And the reason for that is they want it to be the place where you can go and read the newspaper. If you don't get it at home, you can connect with your computer if you have a computer, because there are places to do that right there. And they just want you to be comfortable and feel as if you're in your own living room. And I think it's happened. You can go there, and it's a real, real comfortable place to sit.
One of the amenities in the expanded library is the outdoor fountain in that area. Could you describe that area or tell us about that?
Yes, that is really nice. There's an area between the old building, which is the 1999 building, and the new building, which is 2 years old, which became a courtyard. And it's a lovely area, shaded most of the time. In the afternoon it's shaded, and it has Texas plantings, airscape plantings in there. It's supposed to be easy maintenance and all that, but it has a lovely fountain which the Friends and the LCRA and the city of Pflugerville incorporated in getting. And It plus they also have a rain retention thing, so the water is recycled. It's not, you know, it doesn't evaporate so quickly. And it's really a gorgeous place to go out and take your children or whatever. You can take your lunch out there, and you know. So it's just a nice outside area, the library.
So when the first library moved to 10th Street there, was the John Pfluger Realty already there, or was it the Guaranteed Federal building?
No, it was John Pfluger. It was John Pfluger. Mm-hmm.
And then the deli came. That is probably the most popular place in Pflugerville now, too.
Right, right.
As an eatery.
Yeah, yeah. And the La Petite was there, too. It's on the other corner. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Is there any partnerships with the public school, like with Pflugerville High School, or are the students that walk, or they just simply access the library on their own after school?
I don't know of any of those kinds of things, although our children's department always connects with the school librarians, and the Friends are the ones that go out for when they at the elementary schools when they have school nights for visit, parents coming and that sort of thing. The Friends are the ones that go and provide some information and tell them about the library and that sort of thing. So we're sort of the coordinating thing between the library tells us who wants us to come sometimes, and then we coordinate and go out for that. Also, during the spring, the library promotes their summer reading program, which happens every year in the summertime, and they always send some of their staff out to the schools to tell the kids about it, so they'll be enthusiastic about it too.
Also housed within the present facility is the Friends have a little nook that mm-hmm. is they have book sales there that ongoing.
Right, right. And this is the Friends' current way of making money. We no longer have the big, massive book sales that we used to have, but now we have an ongoing thing that's called Buy the Book, B-U-Y, Buy the Book. And so we have books there, and we change them out regularly. We meet there's a group of us that meets every Tuesday and fixes the shelves and fills them and changes books and that sort of thing. And we don't make nearly as much as we do at the giant garage sales we used to have, but it's a continuing thing, and it helps us maintain our budget for that, you know, which we use for the summer reading program things. We bring in some of their performers that they have during the summer reading program.
Do you know Trudy Marshall?
Oh, yes.
And we're going to talk about volunteerism a little bit more. I don't know if her career title was a librarian, a school librarian, or just a teacher, educator, but she began collecting books also. And do you know about her program? Can you mm-hmm. share a little
sure,
bit
I
about
do.
That?
Actually,
this is a local volunteer.
Yes,
also.
Yes. Actually, Trudy was a volunteer for me at the old house years ago when she was a teacher. And she came regularly and did her job as a volunteer. And then she decided to go back to school, and she went back to school to become a librarian. And then she went over to Canyon Vista or wherever, someplace in Round Rock for her library job. But I don't know how this started for Trudy, but she became somehow knowledgeable about the lack of books in Africa. And connected, I think possibly through her church, with someone over there, and began this wonderful thing called Libraries of Love. And I think it's into its 10th year now. And she's established, she and her volunteers in Africa and her volunteers here have established, I don't know how many libraries in high schools and I think all schools. And so she comes, she has somebody come, one of her volunteers come to the library, to our office, the Friends office, probably once a month, and collect books to take to her African libraries. And wow, it's just really an incredible thing that she's been doing.
It is, and how you don't know where the seed was planted.
Right.
It could have been in that little bitty library. It could have been you're speaking with her. It could have been God sent in some manner or the
mm-hmm.
other. But the reality is the volunteerism in the community, again, that has now spread globally.
Right.
And is impacting minds and lives in another continent. And she's had incredible sometimes scary experiences.
Yes, yes. And she's seen, it's so matter of fact for her. She's telling you about this really awful thing. You think, oh my goodness. And she's going back, you know. We were concerned with the Ebola thing, but she said, no, that's clear away from my area. So.
Well, I think the book sales, again, were a way that as citizens in Pflugerville were, quote, cleaning house,
mm-hmm.
or
mm-hmm.
moving from one office to another, they always thought of the library before doing something with something that might be useful to somebody else.
Right, right. And, you know, long ago, we didn't turn anything away because we needed all those things. And so a lot of the things we had on our shelves in the old house were awful. I mean, they should not have been there. But for one thing, you need a certain number of books to qualify for certain things in the library system. And we were shooting for that. We were shooting for a certain number of volumes per population. And so that, you know, we're working hard to achieve that. And all those donations helped us do that. We didn't have to buy those things. But now we use the donations in a different way. All the donations come into the library, the Friends deal with. And that's what our office is used for mostly. Ordinarily, you know, well, before we used it for the book sales. And now we use it for the buy the book, and we also channel anything the library needs back into the library. And so that helps in that way. And then Trudy comes and gets things that she needs. So, yeah, we use them in lots of different ways.
Is there a program where people can just donate money if they desire? There's a certain level, or that they would go through the Friends if they wanted to donate?
Yes, it would be. We hardly ever experience that, to tell you the truth. But they could become a member of the Friends and donate, you know, a certain amount of money. That'd be fine. Or, of course, they can always donate to the library. But if you donate to the Friends, you get the tax write-off.
Yeah. Well, I know sometimes when people win the big mega books, mm-hmm. that they'll divide it between hospitals, libraries, yeah. or whomever, but the library is always up there as
right.
a good source
yes.
For a donation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much, and thank you for your service to our community, and again, for making such a profound difference.
Well, it's been my pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.